You're listening to the station that's been nominated for a total of 11 awards with the Intercollegiate Broadcasting System, including Best Community College Station for 2 years in a row.
FM.
HD.
Amazon Echo.
Google Home.
The TuneIn Radio app.
The iHeart Radio app.
And nccradio.org.
This is 90.3 WHPC.
WHPC HD.
Garden City.
Long Island.
New York.
WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College. Welcome to another edition of From the Press Box on this Martin Luther King Day, January 21st, 2019. And I am Rob Leonard. Joining me, of course, is my brother and award-winning sports writer, Tim Leonard. Hello, Timothy. How are you doing? And we're both a little under the weather, we should say. I've been under the weather. You know how you know I'm under the weather, brother?
I have no idea.
I'm wearing something over my T-shirt.
Because
usually I don't wear fleece or anything like that. And I'm just trying to stay a little warm. It is like 4 degrees outside. It's pretty warm down here at the station, which is good. But just going outside is crazy.
It's freezing.
Crazy. And I'm getting over the cold, but I thought I was over with like 2 days ago. Because 4 days ago, I couldn't.
There's a lot of relapsing going on, brother.
I was so bad 4 days ago. I literally was, and I don't get sick, as you know. I don't get sick.
Yeah, you do sometimes.
Not like this. This is a long one. Usually it's gone by now. Anyway, today is, like I said, January 21st, 2019. And I want to start off, brother. I'm going to change it around a little bit. Let's start off with, I think, a very important fact for Long Islanders.
What's that?
The New York Islanders are in first place in the Metropolitan Division.
Indeed they are. I posted that on our From the Press Box Facebook page the other day.
I saw that. They are in first place with 62 points. They are 3 points ahead of Columbus. They are 3 points ahead of Washington. They are four points ahead of Pittsburgh.
The fading Washington Capitals, who have lost five in a row.
Isn't that great?
It's awesome.
Because you know, they were just so indestructible for so long.
They were winning a lot of games in a row. And this is what it's about. It's about consistency, brother. It's about winning and getting consistent results.
Yeah.
And I think what we're seeing with the first place New York Islanders is how much difference a good coach can make.
I agree.
Because what did we talk about? What was some of the things that we talked about last season with the now first place New York Islanders?
Their defense was horrible.
Exactly.
And also,
say no more. The defense was horrible.
And teams have histories. The Islanders' history has always been good defense.
Well, but the defense was horrible.
Yes,
that's what
was.
We said last year. And so what happens? The Islanders bring in Barry Trotz because the fading Washington Capitals didn't want to pay Barry Trotz after he won them a Stanley Cup.
That makes no sense.
That's what you call stupid.
Yes,
that's what you call, what is it?
Stupid.
Pound short, I don't know, whatever. It's stupid.
So, Bob used that phrase.
So Barry Trotz comes in, and he makes the Islanders accountable. He tells them, we're going to have to play some defense.
Yep.
Lou Lamoriello comes in to replace the inept, the Trump-like Garth Snow in his ineptitude. And what does he do? He makes one of the quietest moves of the offseason, brother. He signs a little-known goalie by the name of Robin Leonard, who I call Leonard.
It sounds like
Leonard on when they do the broadcast.
They say it like Leonard.
So, signs in Buffalo. The Buffalo Sabres let him go. They just say, hey, you know what? We don't want you anymore. We're good. We're good with goalie. We're good. You're excess. So, what does Robin Leonard do? He's the best goalie in the league. He's got the lowest goals against in the league.
Yep.
This guy stands on his head every night. The Islanders, just the last two games, shutout. You know what? You're not going to lose games if you don't give up any goals.
That's true.
That is what this New York Islanders, this first place New York Islanders team has become. You can't score against them. They get enough goals to win. Last year it was, the offense was going to have to carry the team because the defense was so bad that it was going to be, well, if we don't score five, we're not going to win.
That's right.
Now, Islanders can score two and win. They've given up two goals or less in, I believe it's 18 games. That's phenomenal. It's unbelievable what they're doing defensively and what Barry Trotz has them doing. Matthew Barzal. Now everybody, it was all doom and what's going to happen. John Tavares has left us.
Who's John Tavares is the question.
Pajama boy, as my brother likes to call him. Hey, he's left us. What are we going to do? We don't have our star. Well, you know what? Matthew Barzal has turned into a star.
He has. He took over.
And we're getting a lot more balance from the offense. Who scored three goals in the last two games?
Who would that be, brother?
Cal Clutterbuck.
Clutterbuck. I love Clutterbuck.
Are you kidding me? Cal Clutterbuck. All of a sudden, he's a sniper.
Yep.
This is what I'm talking about, though. Do the Islanders still need to make some moves? Yes, absolutely they do. And I have no doubt that Lou Lamoriello will make moves to make this team a serious and legitimate contender for, you know, before the playoffs start. But right now, Islander fans, enjoy the ride.
Oh, this
because
is fantastic.
I'll tell you what, I like this team. This is a team that every guy who comes to the rink every night, they know they need to put the effort in because they know there's not that superstar. And Barzal can turn into that guy.
Barzal,
he's still improving. What is he, 21?
Yeah,
I mean,
21.
He's a kid.
I think this is like when they get Brian Trottier in many ways.
I don't know about that.
You know, a guy all of a sudden comes in and this big hole is taken over by someone like a Trottier.
Well, but I hate to
compare. You know,
no, they're completely different players.
No, but I'm not talking about the playing style. I'm talking about the fact that all of a sudden it's become Barzal's team. In many ways,
well, because Tavares left, it was Tavares.
Yeah.
I don't get into that hole. You see, you know what?
But
all of that bothers me.
But
when
teams
you say it's somebody's team. It, to me, it's not Barzal's team. Is Barzal a star player? Yes, he is. But that's the beauty of this team, and that to me is when you have a real a quality
well, I,
team.
One
it's
thing
not
I
when you can identify it by one player.
I know that, but I don't want this to turn into one thing I didn't like about Lou Lamoriello is the even though he won three Stanley Cups with the Devils, you know, it's almost like a starless way of doing a
Lou
team.
Lou likes that.
I know that, but the problem is, I hopefully he's learned a little bit that stars are important.
In some regards,
you know,
yes, but
you know,
not in.
Think about the Islanders. You know, the team that won 19 straight. It was a great defensive team.
19 by 19 straight. You mean 19 straight playoff series?
19 straight playoff series.
I'm just letting the listeners know.
But they also had Hall of Fame stars on this team or that team.
Yeah, and, but that team was built through the draft.
Yeah, I know.
It wasn't like they just broke out a checkbook and brought a bunch of guys in.
Well, I'm not saying that they should do that.
But that was a result of great drafting by Bill Torrey.
I know.
Now, the current team, as it's assembled, they've done pretty well in the draft. And Barzal, obviously, was a draft pick for the Islanders, among others. But this is a team, and in this day and age with the NHL... With free obviously free agency hurt the Islanders because otherwise Tavares would still be here, but you know you can say that the most important signing in the offseason was Barry Trotz, because he's completely reversed the culture, and he has made the Islanders, and I said this on Facebook, I just want them to be a relevant perennial contender. Because it's been so long where you could come into a season and just say, all right, you know what? The Islanders have enough talent to make the playoffs. It hasn't been that way in
a long
time.
And they have made the playoffs,
time.
But they've never really got past the first round.
They made the playoffs a handful of times
right.
in the last 20 years.
Right.
I think it's three.
Okay,
all right?
Maybe.
But they've been a perennial outsider. They've been a perennial underachiever. They've been a perennial frustration
right.
because it seems like any time they get a decent player, they got rid of him.
That's right.
And they try and this was all what made Garth Snow such a terrible general manager.
Horrible general manager.
So Lou Lamoriello, let's face it, he didn't have a high bar. There was a very low bar there. For Lou to jump over.
And it wasn't even a jump, it was a little
Lou,
step.
Lou might be an older guy, but he's still, you know, that's how low the bar was. It wasn't difficult for him to clear.
My problem with Lou Lamoriello is he's 76, you know. I want him to be 46, you know.
Well, you know, that's how it is. What are you going to do?
Yeah, I know.
But you know, Lou is training, I believe it's his son, to take over.
Well,
as the GM down the road, and it's probably not a long road because he is 76, as you said.
Yep.
But right now, it's good to be an Islanders fan. They're back at the Coliseum yep. for a handful of games.
Not, well, half the season.
All right, half the season is a handful. 20 it's a couple of handfuls. They're playing well. They're playing inspired hockey. You can tell, like I said, every night, every guy on that team is bringing his game, and they know. It's almost like, in that sense, it's like the Islanders of the early 80s, where every guy came to work, they brought the lunch pail with them, and they said, you know what, tonight could be my night to be a hero. And that's how those teams operated. It wasn't so much that, well, Trottier will get it done or Bossy will get it done.
Right.
Yeah, that was the number one line with Clark Gillies. But every night, that second and third line and the fourth line knew, hey, we got to get it done too.
Yeah.
And the fourth line, it wasn't necessarily about scoring goals. It's about hitting guys and getting out there and getting the team some energy and getting the first line guys an extra bit of rest. But that's like Cal Clutterbuck. Yeah. Anytime he scores, it's a bonus.
I love him.
He got two last night. Are you kidding me? Clutterbuck, beautiful. I love that.
I like the way Josh Bailey's been playing, too.
Hey, Josh Bailey's been outstanding. You know, I like guys like Clutterbuck, Matt Martin, guys like, that just go out and hit people.
Yeah.
And they're just going to go out, and they're going to give you a minute or a minute and 20, and they're just going to hit anything that moves, and they're going to get back to the bench. And by the time they get back to the bench, the building is energized because fans love seeing guys like that. They love seeing guys just work their butts off for their entire shift and just – create some havoc and maybe get a turnover and a scoring chance. But that's the kind of stuff, and especially I think Long Island fans appreciate that as much as anybody. But that is what fans like to see. And that's what I think that this team brings every night. Now, that being said, I'd like to see them maybe get another center.
Hey, like this isn't a complete picture.
No, it's not a finished product by any means.
I mean, this is a nice picture. It's being drawn. But this is something that has to – you need – I agree. Another center would be nice. But I also – you know what? They're playing extremely well. They're in first place right now. I'm extremely happy about this team. And it coincides. We can't say it's connected. But it does coincide the fact that they are back on Long Island. They're playing to sell out crowds 13-9 every time they go to the Coliseum. You know, that's important too, I think. I think this team – has picked up on that, not just the crowd, but you know the fact that you know this is something else too, and who knows? But they practice right over at Eisenhower Park.
Eisenhower Park.
You know they don't have to go to Brooklyn after the practice. You know they just have to like literally drive 20 feet. You know that helps a little relaxation.
Well, they're just like on game days they just have a little pregame skate. That's
right,
all. But they usually do that at the arena. They don't do that at the practice facility.
It depends on where they live. I don't know where all these guys live.
They do that as a team.
Yeah, I know, but do they live all on Long Island or they live in Brooklyn or I don't know.
They practice on Long Island, so they probably live. Most of the guys probably live on Long Island, or they probably live somewhere in between, but. For the most part, I would assume that these guys have cars, so they probably live on Long Island, and when they need to go out to Brooklyn, they'll just either drive out there or take the train or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, it would be easy
it's
to
like
just take
when
the train.
It's like when the Rangers practice in Long Beach, and all the Rangers, you know, lived in Long Beach. So it's
yeah,
like,
because
it's like,
you practice more, right. more than you play.
It's like when I used to work with Stemmer, Pete Stemkowski, and he lived in Long Beach still at that time. He doesn't know anymore, I don't think. But
he said,
"Yeah, you know, we were here for the practice, so you know, and then you just go on the train. Long Beach train would take you right to the garden. So.
Exactly, plenty of trains take you right to the garden.
Right. So anyway, so the Islanders' 15th game and victory is 15th in 18 games.
15 wins in 18 games. They are the second hottest team in the National Hockey League, and I don't know who's first, but I did hear that stat last night. 15 wins in 18 games. You know what? The other thing, as far as the defense goes." And we've been talking about for a couple of years now, the goaltending situation for the Islanders, for once in a long time, is solid.
Well, get this,
Grice seems better than he was last year. Like I said, Leonard is playing phenomenal. And Halak, who his first year, he was very good. In fact, he was an all-star that year. But after that, kind of was shaky. It was always one or the other was shaky. Right now, the Islanders have two solid goalies.
Get this, brother.
What's that?
Islanders have 119 goals against.
Right.
The closest team after that is Boston with 128.
That's what I'm saying. Best defense in the league.
That is, and they're in a different division. The Columbus Blue Jackets, who are second in the Metropolitan Division, 146 goals against.
They are giving up. And
Carolina, 140.
And I don't know if this includes, in fact, I know it didn't include the two shutouts. So now it's under 2.5 goals a game. If I remember the stat, I heard the stat, it was 2.56, and right. and that was before two shutouts. So obviously it's under 2.5 now.
Just incredible. So
they're playing great defense. Yeah, they're smothering teams. They're not giving up great chances. And the times when they do, the goalies have made the saves.
Yep.
And that's all. That timely goals. You're talking playoff team. You're talking a contender. You know, the only there's one team that's run away with, what is that, Tampa Bay. Are you looking at the standings?
Yeah, I do.
Tampa Bay's got something like 12 points more than anybody else in the East.
They have 76. The
Islanders
have 64.
Which is crazy.
Right.
Unbelievable how well
they're playing. Well, the Islanders are the number two team.
Right.
They have 62.
Right.
Yes, the Islanders are the number two team in the Eastern Conference.
In the East, yes. And that's good. That's good.
You should
say,
just
quickly. Home ice will get them.
The Rangers, for a while, were playing well, considering they're in a rebuild year. They are now at the end of the conference. They have 49 points. The Devils, which are just horrible, are in last place with 43 points. So,
they passed the Flyers.
Yeah, the Flyers have 44. And the Rangers are tied with Carolina. So the Rangers were sort of in the middle of it for a while. I give them credit. I mean, I expected the season to be much worse. They almost implied, oh, yeah, don't worry about us. As a matter of fact, if you notice, you see a lot of ads for Ranger tickets.
Of course
buy
you do.
Ranger tickets, you know?
Of course you do. Because Ranger fans are jumping off the bandwagon.
Which is surprising.
They don't want to deal with a rebuild.
That's surprising because usually they're pretty they're pretty loyal, those Ranger fans.
Mm, well.
Anyway, but Islander fans have always been loyal. You know, give them something to cheer. Mm, they're going to be there.
I don't know about that.
No. There were times the Islander fans were treated horribly, you know?
Well, yeah,
I
agree
with
that. When
they were drawing 8,000 at the Coliseum.
Yeah, but if you're drawing 8,000, then you can't really talk about loyalty.
Yeah, but they're being treated like, you know, used rags. So,
well, rags in general are used something. Just to point this out, Matthew Barzal, the only member of the Islanders to make the All-Star team.
Sad.
That seems a little criminal. The way it's set up, though, now with the All-Stars, there's not too many teams that have more than two.
Yeah,
or
like,
even
they
two.
Like to spread it.
Well, because it's so spread out, and it's a three, each division, or what is it? How do they work it? It's whatever it is. It's three different teams, I think, and they play against each other. It's a weird system with the All-Star game in hockey. But actually, the All-Star game is on Saturday, brother.
Okay.
Saturday in San Jose, and Matthew Barzal will be representing the New York Islanders. I'll tell you what, that kid. The wheels on him, unbelievable. I hope he's in the skills competition for fastest skater, because I can't believe that there's anybody faster than him in the league. It's unbelievable the jump that he gets, and the effortlessness, if that's even a word, manner that it doesn't even seem like he's working that hard, and he just pulls away from guys. And I only saw that once when I was covering college hockey.
Right.
There was a kid at RPI, Kelly Askew. He just like kind of wiggled his hips a little bit and it was gone. And other guys would be like pumping their arms and legs, and it's like he's not even moving and he's pulling away from you. Like, how does that happen?
Sure.
And the kid, he could just skate. It's skating is so much about balance,
right.
And Barzal has that kind of balance, and he just pulls away from guys. It's ridiculous.
When last year I started to notice him, I'm like, this guy's good. I like him.
He's really good.
But, you know, one more thing before we go to break.
Yes, bro.
Lou Lamorello did an interview with someone. I forgot who it was. And he was talking about the noisiness of the Coliseum. There is a difference.
The loud barn.
Between the Coliseum and the Barclays.
Yes.
Is the fact that the Coliseum is extremely noisy.
Yeah.
So
loud barn.
I do hope they find a way to make this new Belmont Arena when they finally start building it. There is ways of making it noisy and quiet. So, you know, I hope they find a way to make it noisy.
Well, it's all about how the roof is and how the angle of the seats.
Right,
that's
important stuff.
You know, all that kind of stuff. I mean, that's architect stuff. But I don't know that they're necessarily going to build it according to that.
I
think it also probably has to do with materials
I'm
that
sure
they use as well.
But, yeah, they said that about Yankee Stadium when it first the new Yankee Stadium happened. They said it was much quieter because
there were fewer people.
Well, no. Well, it's 5,000 fewer people. But
that's a lot of people.
But they also said it was just the way it was sort of set up. That you know, that
Yankee Stadium. The new Yankee Stadium is much more steep. It's a steeper.
Well, it's not as steep as old Yankee Stadium.
But it's also the old Yankee Stadium was three tiers,
right?
And the new Yankee Stadium is two tiers.
Yeah,
I'm sure that has something to do with it as well.
Yeah, that's true. So. Anyway, we're gonna take a break right now. You're listening to From the Press Box, right here on 90.3 WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College. Tim, you're on Twitter at?
At Real Tim Leonard.
All hit music.
For all those songs radio has forgotten about, join me, Big Ed, Mondays from 10 a.m. till noon for the Good Gold Show. We'll bring back all the great hits of the 50s, 60s, 70s, and more. The sounds of doo-wop to disco, all the Motown, soul, and great rock and roll. We'll even take your requests and dedications to the Good Gold Show.
Music.
On the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC, and streaming on the iHeartRadio app.
Attention all Long Island residents. This is an important message. Please stand by.
You looking to learn more about Long Island?
Do you need to be informed about the current issues Long Island is having?
Do you want to learn more about what Long Island has to offer?
Yeah, you do!
Listen to My Hometown, where our student and community volunteer hosts explore clubs, organizations, businesses, and issues affecting Long Islanders like you and me. Listen for weekly interviews that shed light on the Long Island towns that are making a difference.
Covering Long Island head to toe, every inch, every mile.
Tune in every Thursday afternoon at 4 or Sunday evenings at 10 on the voice of Nassau Community College 90.3 WHPC.
Hey, that's my job.
You snooze, you lose.
Welcome to the Lions Coffee Shop. May I take your order?
One black coffee with sugar, sweet and low. Oh, don't forget a dash of 90.3 WHPC.
We don't have that, sir.
Sure you do. All you have to do is tell your smart speaker to play WHPC on your Amazon device.
Play us all day, every day, on your smart speaker. The voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
Looking for uncommon talent? Meet the grads of life. They're not the typical candidates you're used to, but they're exactly who your company needs. An ideal fit for entry-level positions, internships, and even mentorships. Go to gradsoflife.org to learn more. Brought to you by the Ad Council and gradsoflife.org.
WHPC, part of the WHPC Sports Talk family, which is from the Press Box, Mondays 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. Sports Talk, 5 p.m. on Mondays. Sports Talk, 5 p.m. on Tuesdays. Sports Talk, 9 p.m. on Thursdays. And on Fridays at 3 p.m. is more Sports Talk. So, lots of sports talk if you want to call up. Actually, the number to call for today, because we're in the process of changing phone lines, is 516-572-0606.
Yeah. 516-572-0606.
And, brother, let us talk. You want to talk about NFL football?
Well, yeah, but one second, bro. I just want to point out someplace else that we're going to be doing a little sports talk today. Is Miller's Ale House after the show.
Go to our website to find out.
We'll be checking that out.
More things as a fundraiser at Miller's Ale House. Percentage of all meals where you come in, say you're here for WHPC, a percentage will be donated to WHPC from Miller's Ale House. So if you want to support us, please do.
And we will be there for lunch, so feel free to come in and
Yeah, sure. If you want to talk sports with us, we'll be talking sports.
Say hello and, you know, tell us how good we are and how much you like the show.
Yeah, sure. So it's 516-572-0606. I was just talking to Rita Monte, who's the perfumer.
We love Rita.
And she was telling me that there was an opera house in Italy when they rebuilt it.
Oh, yeah?
They made sure that the wood matched what was there because they want to have the same sound.
That's a good way to do it.
So, you know, they could do something along those lines with whatever they're going to call
Rita's
it.
Got a lot of information.
She knows
she's
this
like,
stuff.
She's got one of those big brains.
She does.
Where she's just got a lot of information.
Okay, brother, just quickly, Tim Tebow, Major League Spring Training.
That's 9:59.
That's like why? That's all I want to say about why.
I have no answer for you, so let's move on.
Okay, brother, we're going to go back to your alma mater. For those who don't know, Timmy...
we were talking football.
Oh, yeah, we're going to talk football. Okay, we'll talk football. Okay, you want
to
talk football?
Let's give Coach Mihalik a chance to maybe call in. So okay. let's put that off for a little bit.
Anyway, both games yesterday in the AFC Championship and the NFC Championship went to overtime. First time that's ever happened in the NFL playoffs. I really thought the Chiefs were going to win. But you know something? Under 2 minutes... You got to be worried with Tom Brady in there.
It's Tom Brady. He kills to prevent defense. I'll give him that.
As much as I'm not a Brady guy and I hate the Pats, you know what? I sort of knew they were going to pull this out.
You knew that they were going to tie the game up for sure.
Yeah.
Or you know, take the lead when they did, because Kansas City should have killed the clock when instead of scoring the touchdown and giving the Patriots almost 2 minutes to get the ball downfield, which you knew they were going to score. Kansas City should have killed some clock. You know, they should have, instead of scoring a touchdown immediately, they should have tried to kill some clock or at least made New England use their timeouts. I thought that was, obviously you want to score and you don't want to sit there and just run into the pile and because you don't know if you're going to actually make the play when you need to make the play.
Right.
But at the same time, it wouldn't hurt them to run another play and at least kill another 30 or 40 seconds, or, like I said, force the Patriots into using the timeout. Not that they still had them anyway, but, I mean, you know, try to run down the clock anyway, and they didn't do that at all.
They didn't think they needed it. They were playing good in the fourth quarter. So.
The problem that I have with the Patriots and the Chiefs, it had nothing to do with teams on the field. It had to do with the system in the NFL – which, while they maybe have improved it over the years, as far as the overtime goes, it's still far from being a perfect scenario or even a good scenario.
Right.
When the most important play, quote unquote, in the overtime is the coin flip, and that's what happened yesterday.
Yeah, I know. I was very upset.
That's
with a
problem because I mean they turned the overtime when they said, all right, if a team kicks a field goal. Then fine, the other team is going to get the ball. And we're not just going to make it so that whoever scores first wins the game. And that's fine. But they say, if you score a touchdown, game's over.
Which makes no sense.
Which to me is kind of ridiculous because, yeah, the Patriots, hey, I can't fault them. They did what they had to do. They went down, they marched down the field, they scored a touchdown. They converted, I think, 3 third-and-10s, which I was screaming at the television because Kansas City had to stop them on one. I don't know, on the last one of those, the 3rd-and-10, I have no idea why they're not double-teaming Gronkowski when he's lined up wide. I have no idea why the safety wasn't jumping the route. There were so many bad plays made by Kansas City's defense on 3rd-and-10s that it was ridiculous. But all of that being said, the Patriots did what they had to do. They scored the touchdown. Now, the problem that I have with that is that Kansas City never touched the ball in overtime.
Right.
So make it so that, yes, if they score a touchdown, that's all well and good. But are you going to kick the extra point or are you going to go for two? Because right. Now if you go for two, now you're guaranteeing, if you make it, now you're guaranteeing that the worst that can happen is you're going to wind up tied.
Right,
but to the fact that the other team never gets the ball and never has the chance to do anything in the overtime, it means that the coin toss is still a far too important happening in the overtime. And that was why they said, well, if you score a touchdown, then you win the overtime and it doesn't matter. The coin flip still means too much.
It's all important. It's a whole game. I think it should be like it's a 7-minute period or something.
Well, it's a 15-minute period.
But it should be the
7 minutes isn't enough.
Okay.
The Patriots ran off probably close to 7 minutes
okay,
on that drive.
So then you say, okay, then you have to play 15 minutes total. So, you know, okay, let's say you get the touchdown at 10 minutes, that means the other team has 5 minutes or maybe 5 minutes left. But I think it should be a total period. It makes no sense, you're right, that the coin flip, you know, there's no skill in picking a coin flip.
No.
You know,
Patriots pick heads. It was heads. You know, okay.
And it's sometimes better or worse, depending on the team, how they're going to play it. You know, if you're the Pats, you want to be on offense.
Of course, every team in overtime wants to be on offense first, because you don't know what's going to happen. If you score a touchdown, the game's over.
I know they try to make it like sudden death, and then, you know, that's the term that they use. But you know what? It's a different game now.
The other thing that they could do is go to what college does. College overtime has become a very exciting situation because it's put the ball on 25. I think
that's just as phony as the...
It's a gimmick.
The one-touch thing.
It's a gimmick, but what happens? This team scores a touchdown, the other team comes back. If they score a touchdown, fine. Now we're going to another overtime, or what they call an overtime. So that's why college, when you hear these games and they have like six overtimes, that just means teams kept scoring.
Right. That's not real either. So.
Well, but it's more real because if your defense comes up with a stop, the game, you know, then the game is pretty much over because all you have to do is get a field goal. But that's why it's only 25 yards. It's a short field. It's let's make something happen. And when you get close to the goal line, that the end zone, like how many analysts have said in the past, it becomes a 12th man.
Right.
Because it shortens the field. It makes it that much harder. But I go back to a college game this year between Ohio State and Maryland. Because, you know, I'm a big Maryland fan.
Go Terps.
Ohio State, in the second overtime, in the first overtime, Ohio State scored a touchdown. Maryland scored a touchdown. Kicked the extra points. Boom, second overtime. Ohio State comes down. They score a touchdown. Maryland comes down, and they score a touchdown. Now Maryland says, you know what? We're nowhere near as good as Ohio State is, so we're going for two. We're going to try and win the game right now because this is not, you know, we're not going to be able to hang with this team for six overtimes.
Right.
So Maryland goes for the two, goes for the win. They missed it because the quarterback just threw a terrible pass. They really should have won that game. But that makes it more exciting because what are they going to do with the extra point? And, I mean, I'm just looking for solutions here. But right now, what the NFL has in place is just not good. It's not worthy of what the game is when you have the two best teams in the AFC playing for the right to get to the Super Bowl, and you go to overtime, and one of the teams doesn't even get a chance to go on the field on offense.
Yeah, it makes no. It's just not fair.
It's just horrible.
It's a bad. It's Bush League. It reminds me of they're doing it in minor league baseball right now. They're starting they'll put a guy on second base.
I hate that.
I hope in the extra.
I hope they're not going to do it this year. I know they did it last year. I just think that's the dumbest thing in the world.
Oh, I agree. But my problem is that someone thought this was a good idea.
Well, I think they're just experimenting with stuff, and I don't mind the experimenting, but that's just a bad rule in the first place. Because how do you put a guy in second? You know, if your pitcher is pitching well enough, first of all, if the pitcher gives up a single and there's a guy on second, chances are this run is going to score.
Oh, of course.
And so all they've done is there's no work involved. You get one hit. I mean, you know, if you get a home run, then fine, that's worth a run. But the guy on second base, it could be, you know, ground out, sacrifice fly, and you have a run.
Yeah.
What did you do to earn a run? Nothing.
Nothing. I don't like it. I
hate it.
Yeah, I hate it. I hope
hate.
They talk about, you know, well, we don't want 18-inning games anymore. Yeah, no, I like 18.
Well, I mean, I know the players don't like them, and travel reasons are a big part of that, especially in the minor leagues. But even so, with Major League Baseball, they all have their own jets. But sports writers, that's a problem.
Sure, of course.
You know, sports writer has a flight after the game, and all of a sudden they got to cover an 18-inning game. Now you got problems.
Well, that's true. So anyway, the Patriots defeated the Chiefs, and the Rams defeated the Saints. They're going to be looking at this game for a while, aren't they?
The Rams were just so bad in the first half, and they really didn't deserve to win this game. And even worse, this pass interference call that wasn't called, that was just so blatantly obvious.
Right.
I don't know what the refs were looking at. I don't know why didn't one ref? I mean, you can't put it on one guy. There should have been four flags that came out, and there weren't any. So how did so many different guys miss this call? You know, the Rams the Rams DB Nickel Roby Coleman just ran through Tommy Lee Lewis. That's his name. The Saints wide receiver.
Okay.
And not only ran through him a decent amount of time before the ball even got there, but there was also a helmet-to-helmet contact there. So there was two things. The helmet-to-helmet, which is a flag.
Right.
The pass interference, which is a flag. And pass interference, which would have given the Saints the ball inside the 10, first down. Thank you very much. We're about to score a touchdown.
Yep.
So, or even a field goal. But even any of that happens, and the Saints win the game. Because the game doesn't go to overtime. So, it's astounding to me. And then Sean Payton goes into the post game press conference, and the first thing he says is that the league has already called him and already told him that our guys missed the call, just blatantly missed
right.
it. And well, what are they going to do? They can't put him back out on the field.
No, you can't.
And Payton was like, yeah, and there. By the way, yeah, they said there was also the helmet to helmet, and they're just not really sure how all of that was missed on one play. And I'm like, I, who knows how it was missed? The guys all had their eyes closed. I have no idea how officials can be that incompetent. It boggles my mind. It just absolutely boggles my mind how incompetent they were on that play. And it seems like every week that we have NFL officials making some other boneheaded call or non-call, and this one was among the worst of the season. Now this refereeing team,
right.
I guarantee you they won't be doing the Super Bowl.
No. They've already announced the people.
Well, but this was just it was just abominable, and I don't know what the NFL is going to be doing about its officiating issues. But they seem to be getting worse. The players get bigger and faster, and the referees don't—they haven't been able to adjust. And I think that's kind of where we are, and that's part of the problem is that the players are so much bigger and stronger that the referees just haven't been able to catch up. And I don't know if that means finally for the NFL to go to full-time referees and officials, or how they can do it.
Well, but they don't want to pay him full time.
No, they don't. That's part of the problem.
The refs don't make a lot of money in the NFL.
Obviously, they don't. A lot of these guys are like insurance agents. They have real jobs.
Yeah.
But the NFL is going to have to do something because the quality of the officiating has to be better. And what happened to the Saints? I mean, think about it. If you're the Saints, if that flag gets thrown, you're going to the Super Bowl.
Yep.
A call doesn't get any bigger than that. Unless it's in the last 30 seconds of the Super Bowl and it decides that game.
And it's not just a standing thing and a pride thing of making the Super Bowl. It's also a money thing for the team.
Of course.
So, I mean, that's part of it, too. I'm surprised. You know, the NFL's have problems with refs for a long time.
Yeah.
And part of it is that these guys are not full-time during the season. You know,
that's a decision that at some point the NFL is going to have to make. And here's the other situation. All right, I know they want older officials because those guys have more experience. But if you're able to train officials in the NFL like they do with baseball. Baseball, and the difference is obviously the baseball has the minor leagues, and those guys learn the strike zone, and they learn how to umpire a game. But if you were able to put younger referees into situations that would allow them to train for game situations in the NFL, you're going to wind up with better referees.
Right.
And, I mean, think about it. How many young officials are there out there? There aren't that many.
No, not in the NFL.
The ones who are younger, I think, are the sons of former referees. Who was that guy with the guns? What was his name? The guy who was all jacked with the...
What, ref?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Something. I forget his last name. But his son now is... Type in Google. Type in jacked referee. I'm telling you, he'll come up. But his son now is doing it, and his son has the guns too. But it was like the big joke was that this guy would come out, and you know, even in 10-degree weather, he'd have the short sleeves on because he wanted to show off the guns. But that is what you get. So many referees in the NFL are in their mid to late 50s or older.
Okay, Ed.
Hockley, that's his name. That's right, Ed Hockley. His son now is a referee, though. You don't. How could you not notice that guy? You've never seen him. It's a jacked up ref, but I couldn't think of his last name.
He's an American attorney and retired American football.
Exactly. Does it say what his age is? He just retired a year or two ago.
He's born in 1950. So, what is that?
1950. So that's 69 or 68. But yeah. He just retired a couple years ago. So that.
Okay. Here's some pictures of him.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, he's pretty jacked.
Of course he's jacked. Look at him.
Okay.
So, but that is my point with him is too many refs are getting up there in age.
Right.
And you don't have a whole lot, if any, like 30-year-olds. And that's what the NFL needs, is some younger eyes,
no minor
quicker
leagues. And
there's no, that's the problem. I don't know where you're training, but that's, if you turn it into a full-time gig. And it's not like these guys, it's not like Ed Hockley is leaving his law practice on Friday to say, hey, I got to get to Cincinnati and do a game this weekend. He can be in Cincinnati on Wednesday or Thursday and be studying film or doing whatever kind of training that they want them to do.
Running.
Well, no, I mean, most of these guys are in shape. I mean, for the most part, you don't see fat referees. But in terms of... who knows? Maybe they have them call high school games. I don't know. I don't know what the answer is to that. But put them out there on a field and get them experience with doing what they have to do to become better referees. And if that means doing college games, doing high school games, whatever it is, just do games.
Well, that's I think a great idea. Also, you know, with the two new football leagues coming up, Vince McMahon's league and Charlie Ebersole's league, we'll see what happens with that. You're listening to From the Press Box right here on 90.3 WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College. I'm Rob Leonard. He's Tim Leonard. If you want to make a comment or question or have a question, give us a call, 516-572-0606 for today only.
Hello, this is Uwe Riggers, host of the German Hit Parade. Tune in every Monday evening at 7 to hear many of the most popular German recording artists of the past 60 years. Hört euch die schönen Lieder an. During our 60-minute show, you will also hear about the latest events in the German-American community, and you will never know who may turn up live at our studios or at what event we may turn up live. So tune in every Monday evening at 7 for the German Hit Parade on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHBC.
What color do you think of when you think of winter?
White, like snow.
Okay, sure, but I think of red.
Well, green and red, like Christmas colors.
Nope, just red.
Why's that?
Because it's almost time for the Nassau Community College New York Blood Center and Long Island Blood Services 24th Annual Midwinter Blood Drive. It's happening Thursday, January 24th from 9 to 5 in the CCB on the Nassau Community College campus. Gain the warm feeling from helping to save a life or two. More information is available by calling 516-572-7401 or online at ncc.edu.
Saturday Night Fever. Polyester suits. The Brady Bunch. Bell-bottom jeans. And the music of the 70s.
Knock three times on the ceiling if you want me.
Join me, Ron Stevens, on the radio, Saturday mornings at 7 a.m. for 2 hours of the decade of Elton John, the Eagles, and disco. The Super 70s, the 70s at 7, Saturday mornings on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
You're listening to 90.3 WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College. From the press boxes on your radio or on your listening device on the iHeartRadio app, or maybe on the TuneIn app, of course, nccradio.org is where it begins. Also, our show becomes a podcast later on. If you miss it at any time, or you want to hear it again, or you want to say, hey, Tim Leonard said something, you got to hear it again, go to Spreaker.com, but it's also on the iHeart app. It's on all the available places you find podcasts. But it starts at Spreaker.com, so we'll just mention that. Okay, brother, we've talked about the NFL. Let's see. We talked about the Islanders. Let's quickly talk about the Yankees, brother. Sonny Gray got traded
to
the Reds.
Well, he's on the verge of being traded.
Ah, okay.
The deal has not been finalized yet, but the Yankees are working, there's physicals and the deal is never really a deal, but they're also, I think, still possibly negotiating as far as what the compensation will be. Right now, as it stands, there is supposedly a deal in place that will send Sonny Gray to the Reds for a second base prospect by the name of Shed Long. Yes, his first name is Shed.
Shed.
He is, according to MLB.com, he is the Reds' number seven prospect. The Reds actually have a pretty good system, but it's about their top seven.
Right.
But that's deeper than a lot of teams. But the Yankees were never going to get one of their top four guys.
Well, that's
so. The number five is a pretty decent pitcher, and number six is a catcher who they like as their catcher of the future. So it was probably it was going to say, all right, we're going to start at seven, and if you don't like him, then tough.
Okay.
Because they didn't want to give up. The kid's name is Tyler Stevenson, the catcher. The Yankees also will get what they call a sandwich pick. And that is a draft pick that should be between 35. That is. I'm going to ignore that. That is a draft pick that should be somewhere between 35 and 40, which means that from that pick, the Yankees should get a pretty damn good player. You're talking about one of the top 35 players in available in the draft. I mean, that's basically a first round pick. It's a late first round pick, but it's a first round pick. So that should net them a quality player. And from what I've heard, the Yankees are supposed to get another low-level minor leaguer. But that, I think, is kind of what the wrangling is about in terms of, well, we're taking your number seven guy, so we want maybe a little bit better on the low-level guy, as opposed. And I mean, let's face it, this could still fall apart. It trades don't always happen like we think they're going to happen, but from what I heard, it's going to happen. It's just a matter of, what, as they say, crossing the T's, dotting the I's, et cetera, et cetera.
We should say, we got to mention this last week, partly because we weren't in the same room. Mel Stottlemyre passed away.
Very soon.
Truly a guy who came as a Yankee at the wrong time. Almost like a Mattingly.
Great Yankee.
In his generation's Mattingly, in the sense that he sort of came up at the wrong time. He was 64 to 70. I have to check that out.
75, I think it was. I don't know. I'm not 100% sure. I tell you what, I'll give you a story about Mel Stottlemyre from my friend Dave Buscema, his book, Game of My Life. The game that Stottlemyre picked was a shocker, and the reason that it was a shocker was because instead of a famous Mel Stottlemyre win, he actually picked a game that he pitched against Vita Blue. Now, this was like early 70s when Vita Blue was untouchable and, sure. and was winning Cy Young Awards, and I think he won 27 games in one season. It was ridiculous. His kids were in town for the game. And they were staying either at his apartment or at a hotel or whatever it was. And Mel's getting ready to go to the ballpark. And he tells his kids, hey, you know, Daddy's got to go to the ballpark, et cetera, come on, let's get ready. And his kids say, oh, Dad. And remember who his kids are. I mean, his kids were, you know, Todd and you know, like his kids wound up being a couple of major league pitchers.
Right.
But at that point, they were, what, 8 or 9 or 10 or whatever. And his kids say, Daddy, who are you pitching against today? Oh, yeah, I'm going against Vita Blue. And they're like, there's no way you're going to win this game. His kids were telling him, Dad, there's no way you're going to win today. Mel goes out and pitches a two-hit shutout.
Well, I can see why he
won the game 2-0.
I can see why he actually liked that game because he showed his kids.
Yeah, so he goes back and tells the kid, hey, Daddy's pretty good.
Yeah.
You know? Vita Blue, no, sorry. Daddy's pretty good.
Yeah.
So that was the game. A very entertaining chapter in my boy Buscema's book. That was actually one of the better ones just because it wasn't, you know, it wasn't Dave Rigetti throwing a no-hitter
right.
or it wasn't, you know, Derek Jeter with a flip play or whatever. It was just some random game that nobody remembers, but Mel Stottlemyre sure did remember it because it had a lot of family history and family implications with it.
Get this pitching stats here, brother.
What do you got? What do you got for me, brother?
64-74.
Yeah.
Made the World Series once with the 64 team, which lost to the Cardinals, when I think he pitched against Bob Gibson all
probably.
Three games.
That would make sense.
He was 20-game winner 3 times.
Yep.
He was 164-139. He had
good
a 2.97.
Good record on some not-so-good teams.
Yeah, 2.97 ERA. That's pretty damn good, considering the 65 to really 72 Yankees were just
dreadful.
Just not something you wanted to watch. And he was the guy.
And went past 72. I don't know why you stopped at 72.
Well, 72, they started to get better, the Yankees. 73 and 74.
73 was
6-7, and I guess that's the year he...
That was when Munson came on the scene, and yeah. Mercer started to be a player, and, you know, they kind of, you know, got past what was known as the Horace Clark years.
Right, but
poor,
you know,
Horace.
Poor Horace is right. He gets blamed for a lot of things.
Yeah, well, he wasn't a good player.
Yeah. Anyway, so his records, you know, God, if he came up, you know, 10 years later or whatever.
Came up 10 years later, they wouldn't need a catfish hunter.
That's true. You're right.
You know?
Right. That's a great point.
And they could have saved a lot of money.
That's true. And he won 5 World Series as a pitching coach with the Yankees and Mets.
And the Mets.
And Doc Gooden had a nice statement about Mel saying that he helped him so much, and, you know, he did.
Mel helped a lot of pitchers. Yep. He obviously helped a lot of Yankees pitchers, and yeah, I mean he's a guy that you know, a lot of behind the scenes stuff, a lot of stuff, especially as a coach that doesn't get recognized like what players do. But Mel was as good a pitching coach as there was.
Yep.
You know, this is a guy who, you know, if he had left the Yankees, he would have had a job the next day.
Oh sure.
And that's you know, that's how it went. And you know, it's sad. He was dealing with cancer for a lot of years. He had the blood cancer, myeloma,
right?
But you know, pretty much was living with it, and you know, it finally caught up to him. 77 years old. So, you know, our condolences to
he made it to 77. So yeah. That's not bad.
So condolences to the Stottlemyre yep. family and the Yankee and Met families and.
Yep.
You know, the baseball world and the world in general lost a really good guy.
A good guy. So, we got about 5 minutes left, brother, so we got a couple of things to talk about.
We got some more Yankee stuff here, brother.
Well,
I just want to throw out here.
Quickly, brother. There's not much here.
The Yankees have signed reliever Adam Ottavino.
Ottavino.
To a 3-year contract worth $27 million. The Yankees bullpen is ridiculous. It's so far and away the best bullpen of all time, as far as I'm concerned, right now. It's certainly the best bullpen in the major leagues today. They have just an embarrassment of riches. I'm of the mindset that Chad Green, who has been a lights out seventh inning guy for them, should be stretched out, and they should think about starting him. He used to be a starter, and they turned him into a relief pitcher kind of out of need, and he blossomed and just struck guys out left and right. It was ridiculous. But he came up as a starter. I think he would prefer to be a starter. And with the numbers that the Yankees have in the bullpen and the lack of depth, really, in the rotation, I really think they should stretch out Green during spring training and see what he can give them in terms of possibly starting, especially if somebody gets hurt. And I don't expect CC Sabathia to go through a full season without getting hurt. You don't know what's going to happen with Tanaka, with his elbow. You should be safer rather than sorry. And you still have Jordan Montgomery, who's coming back from the Tommy John surgery, but he probably won't be back until June or July. So I think it would be a good idea. And, you know, who knows? If you catch some lightning in a bottle with Green as a starter like you did with him as a reliever, now you're talking about having a guy who can give you six strong innings or seven strong innings. And like I said, with this bullpen, all a starter for the Yankees has to do is give him five innings at this point. I mean, they have so many arms in the bullpen and so many power arms. I mean, you're talking about Aroldis Chapman, Dellin Betances, Zach Britton, and Ottavino. All of those guys have closing experience. So it's just, like I said, it's an embarrassment of riches. And Ottavino, who's a Brooklyn guy, he comes to the Yankees and you know, I think he's just going to add to it. It makes the Yankees a little bit stronger, and it certainly makes them even a little bit more of a contender.
And finally, brother, we got about 3 minutes before Big Ed takes over with the Good Gold Show. Keep it tuned here, yes. WHPC. Your alma mater, Timothy.
Yes, Hofstra University.
Hofstra University, the Flying Dutchman.
Well, they call themselves the Pride now, but I call them the Flying Dutchman.
I like the Flying Dutchman. I never understood why they got rid of that.
Michigan, brother, Michigan lost to Wisconsin on Saturday.
Right.
And then Virginia lost to Duke later that same evening.
And who is the only undefeated team?
So right
in the
now,
league?
No, that's not correct. Really? So right now at this moment, brother, the longest current winning streak the entire country.
Ah.
The entire 50 states of the United States of America. The longest current winning streak belongs to Hofstra University.
Isn't that incredible?
14 wins in a row.
Wow.
And we were hoping to have Coach Mihalik on today, but I guess we're not going to get that done.
He's probably
but
not around.
14 wins in a row. We're talking here are the Justin Wright Foreman, brother. I know you know that name. He is a senior guard, and you rarely hear seniors in college basketball. But this is Hofstra, and you know these guys aren't going pro. Although Justin Wright Foreman at some point probably could go pro somewhere. He is averaging 26.2 points per game.
Wow.
The senior guard. He is a local product, brother. He's out of Queens.
Okay.
Junior guard Eli Pemberton, he averages 15.2 points per game. He's from Connecticut. Senior Deshaur Bowie, I hope I'm pronouncing that right. It's a tough name. He's from the Bronx. He's a point guard from the Bronx, so you know he's good. 9.5 points per game and 5.1 assists. Hofstra, they're an up-tempo team, brother. They score 82.4 points per game. They beat Charleston on Saturday, 86-72. That makes them 7-0 in the Colonial Athletic Association. Your boy Pemberton led the way with 26 points and 5 rebounds.
Wow.
Hofstra's only 3 losses this season have come to Marshall, Maryland, and VCU,
game
was in overtime.
Undefeated.
No, 17-3.
Oh, okay.
But they were 3-3, and now they're 17-3. 14 wins in a row. So that is the longest current winning streak.
Okay.
Michigan and Virginia both were undefeated, but they both lost.
Ah, so they're the
they only
the
have one loss each now.
Continuous. Okay, I thought they were undefeated.
The longest current winning streak.
Ah.
Okay. So, and Hofstra will be playing Thursday at James Madison. Their next 3 games are on the road. All 3 of those losses, Marshall, Maryland, and VCU, were on the road. Hofstra goes to James Madison on Thursday. Saturday they will be playing at Towson State. And February 2nd they will be playing at Northeastern. That's Croce School, by the way.
Okay.
We beat them. We beat them already. 75-72.
Anytime we beat Croce, it's good.
And but that one's on the road. Northeastern is the second place.
Who's on Facebook listening to us? Because we do put this on Facebook. Who is it? Mike Adesso.
Mrs. Tuck is listening.
Mrs. Tuck. We have Philly.
Our
Phil
sister.
Saros,
our sister is listening. David Johnson is listening. Lots of people.
Croce
Vicky. No, he's not there. Vicky Impey is listening.
All right. So thank you to our Facebook crowd.
Lots of big crowd on the Facebook Live today.
We also put this on Facebook Live. That just about does it. Coming up next is Big Ed, and he is ready to play the oldies with the Good Gold Show right here on 90.3 WHPC. Timothy, you're at Twitter at
Real Tim Leonard.
See you all next Monday. Take care.
The views expressed on air are not necessarily those of WHPC, its management, or Nassau Community College. Responsible opposing viewpoints will be considered by emailing them to whpc@ncc.edu or by mail at WHPC, One Education Drive, Garden City, New York, 11530. Thanks for listening to the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
Hi, this is Michael Anthony. Engineer and producer of Music is Therapy. Please join us throughout the month of January right here at 90.3, Thursdays at 3:30 p.m. as we air the final four programs of Music is Therapy. Larry Carlson, the longtime host, fought a brave battle with cancer for more than a year and unfortunately lost that battle on December 5th. However, not long before that, Larry returned to the station to record four brand new programs, and it is our honor to broadcast these shows as Larry would have wanted them to air. It was not only Larry's goal to tout the therapeutic aspects of music through his program, but it was also his goal to discuss health topics and issues that would better the life of people both physically and mentally. So please join Larry for his final four programs of Music is Therapy, Thursdays at 3:30 p.m. right here on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.